will reach nearly gale force in coastal areas there too. Cold with overnight lows of 1 to 4 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
The Football Show on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Fake crowd noise? The Emirates never sounded so good.
Gamble responsibly. See WE.net.
I'm prepared to do anything I can. Well, do it then.
Do it then. What about your start to the game?
It wasn't bad, was it?
Why should have an honest answer be a mistake?
How can a modern day manager not have a mobile phone?
Why should he?
It is Thursday's Football Show. Nathan with you for the next hour. Arsenal leading Olympiacos 1-0 in the Europa League. Spurs 1-0 up against Dinamo Zagreb. Earlier, Manchester United conceded an injury-time equaliser in a 1-1 draw against AC Milan in their game at Old Trafford. While Rangers, well, they also pulled off a good result for the new Scottish Premiership champions. A 1-1 draw for them in Slavia Prague. Coming up later, we will chat to Vinny Perth. He's going to talk us around the whole process with pro licences. Obviously, it's been a big story in Dundalk. It was a story when Vinny himself was the Dundalk manager as to what goes on within the course, how difficult it is to get on it, and just a look at the overall coaching structure for people looking to make progress within Ireland. We'd also touch on the news this evening that Darren Randolph has been ruled out of the game against Serbia in a couple of weeks' time. Stephen Kenny also revealing in a fans question and answer session that Caoimhín Kelleher is a major doubt. So big problems for Ireland once again ahead of the opening World Cup qualifier against Serbia. Right now though, I am delighted to be joined on the line by John Hartson. Evening, John.
Good evening.
First off, I want to apologise on behalf of my colleagues. I was tuned into yourself talking to Jair a few weeks back, and he was still giving it the big one about Ireland and Wales, and I just think I should apologise on his behalf. I think he's let us all down. He's embarrassed himself and all of us.
Well, it wasn't just the defeat. It was the way that I think Jay went a bit over the top in terms of trying to belittle a couple of Wales players and maybe calling a couple of players over the hill. And I said to him that that will potentially come back and bite you in the bum, Jay. And that's exactly what happened, you know. So I wasn't going to mention the rugby tonight. You know, I'm a humble guy. I don't bring it up too often, but, you know.
I've given you the opportunity. Revel in the glory. Why not? Triple crown winners, eh? Lucky triple crown winners, some might say.
Yeah, so well. That ever so well, put 40 points on England, you know, beat the resurgent Scotland team, who have really been going well of late, as the Scotland team have. And obviously Wales, Ireland, I always see as our toughest game anyway. You know, Ireland can pull off a result at any time. They've got such good players, great flair in the back row there. So Wales, we play Italy now on the weekend, and then we finish with France. So it would be nice to go through and win all five games. You know, that'd be a great achievement for the boys. And when you think that they really weren't overly fancied, I think, you know, I think maybe England, Ireland possibly would have started favourites.
Written off, John, I would say.
Yeah, possibly. But again, I think, you know, I think you're the same. The Irish are the same when you write them off. You know, they come out fighting and you push them into a corner. And they come out fighting, you know. Wales are showing under Alan Wynne-Jones again, 150-odd caps. I remember when Paul O'Connell was, you know, what a monster of a man, a leader for Munster all them years. You know, you write off, you know, the Ireland rugby team at any stage when he was in there, you know, he would galvanise the rest of the players. And Alan Wynne-Jones, you know, he's very similar to that in terms of a leader, a captain, a former, you know, Lions captain as well. And you don't write these people off. And Arlen Wynne is that type of character.
Let's talk football then. Where do you want to start? Celtic or Arsenal?
I don't mind. You can talk a bit about Celtic if you want. I think Celtic are in the process of getting a new manager.
Mm. The process of the last few months with the real struggle that Neil Lennon has had, and we've had yourself over, we've had Neil Lennon over, loads of different Celtic players from that great Celtic side under Martin O'Neill, and there's a brilliant bond between ye when you're together. An awful lot of that team are now pundits and have had found themselves in a position where they've had to be extremely critical of Neil Lennon. How did you find that?
Well, I was one of the only ex-players who actually backed Neil. I backed him to the hilt, and it got to a stage where, to the detriment of backing him, and you know, a poor result after a poor result, a disappointing performance. Celtic were just getting, you know, Rangers were getting further and further away. There was no chance that Celtic were going to claw back a 21-point deficit. Rangers had to lose seven games. They hadn't lost all season. That was never going to happen. So I went with my heart, and you know, and sometimes, you know, as a pundit worth his salt, I think you've got to, what you call is you've got to call it as you see it. And at the start of the season, I thought Celtic were in good hands under Neil, but then it just seemed to fall away. And in the end, I spoke from the heart and I said, look, I think it's time for a change. Neil had a little reaction to that. Rather than say, you know, well, John's backed me all year. He's one of the few who actually have given me support. You know, John's a pundit. He has to do his job. He has to call it as he sees fit. And instead, I think he went down a different route and said that he was disappointed with my comments. But I think still, Ian Petrov called for Roy Keane to take charge. He actually named Roy Keane while Neil was still in the job. I think Chris Sutton, I've said many times on air, Neil can't survive this run of results. And as much as I sat next to Neil Lennon for 5 years in the Celtic dressing room, we're great friends. And, you know, if I was a manager or a coach, then, you know, I'm looking myself in the eye and I'm saying to myself, well, you know, it's justified. Because, you know, I'm taking a team that such an unprecedented season, you know, heading, we all know what was at stake. And the team, the formation, the tactics, everything kept changing week after week. There was a problem, one problem after another. And while this is all going on, Rangers are sort of just sort of stealing a march and getting further and further away. And there's no doubt that Neil can't be held accountable for every decision that's gone wrong at Celtic this season. I think there's many of things. You can start with the recruitment. You can start with the players. Maybe they took their eye off the ball. Maybe they just thought this season that it would just happen. And they've been surprised by Rangers' form. Remember, Celtic have lost two games to Rangers this season. So, you know, I'm absolutely fine, and I'm sure the other lads are fine. And, you know, Neil was hanging on to his job, and he's a very proud man. You know, he's been a legend at Celtic, both as a player and a manager. You know, he's had tremendous success, and that'll never ever sway away from what he's done for the club. And I think rightly so, you know, the Celtic fans, and I will certainly remember, you know, what a good job that he's done. It's just this season, it all just seemed to implode on the pitch, and it also imploded off it. So I've not got an issue. I'm a little bit disappointed with Neil's remarks. But listen, he was an angry man. You know, he was coming out fighting, and the trip to Dubai, and I think they spoke to him about what I thought the next day after a press conference where it all sort of, it all came out, where Peter Lowell had apologised for the trip to Dubai, and then Neil went and did his press conference the next day and almost defended the team for going to Dubai, and was on about the First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, had gone too far and everything else with the criticism of the Dubai trip. And I think the camera was shoved in his face at that time, which was probably the worst time to ask him about it.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was that. But no, listen, as I said, I go back to it. I think pundits worth their salt have to call things as they say, to the detriment sometimes of, you know, having to say things about your friends.
So what do you do next? Do you give it 3 months and give them a call and or just run into each other?
Yeah, we probably bump into each other. I don't know. I really don't know. You know, as I said, I I was his biggest supporter. You know, I give him more backing than anybody else. He had my back, and he knew he had my back. But I think what Neil has to appreciate is that he's in a very privileged position, Celtic manager. And I'm a pundit and have been a pundit for 12 years since I retired. And I wouldn't be doing my job if I never called it as I saw it. And I backed him to the hilt. And it got to a stage where I think it was 19 points. And I just could not defend Neil anymore.
Yeah.
And as I said,
you
I think
your own reputation to protect as well.
Well, exactly. And I was getting, you know, I'm not too bothered about that anyway, because I can live with that. You know, you live and die by what gets said on Twitter. You can take it as a pinch of salt, or, you know, you can let it affect you. So I don't take too much notice of social media, because if I did, I'd be off it. I've not got 400,000 followers and 120,000, you know, Instagram followers for nothing, because I'm a decent bloke. And, you know, I think people can value my opinions as they see it.
Hope you're using all those followers and making...
I might come off it.
The influencer lifestyle could be yours.
I don't even like social media. Honest to God, I don't like it. I really don't. I don't know why I'm on there. I'm a father of five kids, and, you know, my dad says to me, what on earth are you doing? Why are you leaving yourself wide open to idiots to get back to you and, you know, abuse you and do this and do that? And I say, Dad, I don't know. And he's like, well, have a think about it, son. You know, what are you doing? And so, honest to God, I'm not... It can be good for some things, you know. If you're an ambassador for certain things, you can back certain companies and everything else. You know, but other times I think there's so many dimwits on there that the dimwits outweigh, you know, the decent people at times, you know.
What next then for Celtic? Because I'm looking at the odds for who will get the job on a permanent basis. And John Kennedy is a short price favourite. He was there as Neil Lennon's assistant. Roy Keane is once again in the mix. Eddie Howe, who's long been linked with potentially following the Brendan Rodgers route. Enzo Maresca is an interesting name. He's in charge of the Manchester City elite development squad. Derek McGuinness, who's just left Aberdeen. And then you go through the likes of a return for Martin O'Neill or Rafa Benitez, Sean Dyche. What type of figure do Celtic need next if they're to ensure that Rangers don't push on from here under Steven Gerrard and actually go on a run of titles themselves?
Well, I think they need a manager that can organise a team and put them into a structure, put them into a formation and stick with it. I know when you come up against certain teams, in particular in Europe, you have a look at them, you study them, and you might just have to change your system to accommodate, you know, to try and affect the opposition. But when I was at Celtic for 5 years, we didn't change. We played three at the back, under Martin. Gordon Strachan changed it a little bit, went to a four, went back to a five. You know Martin O'Neill's system. He played it at Villa. He's played it everywhere he's been. It's three centre-halves who can head the ball, who are very strong. And he played with wing-backs, with great delivery from the left in Alan Thompson, on the right in Didier Agat. He had two internationals and a European Cup winner in front of the back four, Paul Lambert and Neil Lennon, who intercepted and kept the ball. Two great athletes in the middle of the park. Then he had Stan Petrov, who would be the one out of them three in the middle of the park that would generally, him and Paul Lambert, Lenny would generally always sit and protect the back three as a little bit of insurance for the back three. And then Stillian or Paul Lambert would generally gamble and run into the box and support the forwards when crosses came in. And then we had played two up front. So we played five, sort of 3-2. We always played with two strikers, whether that was Henrik Larsson and myself or Chris and Henrik. And if it was me and Henrik, Chris Sutton would generally drop back into midfield.
Yeah.
Or he would go one of the three centre-halves. So I think one of the problems that Celtic have had this season is they've not settled on a system. They've not settled on a formation.
Whatever about the system, John, like that 11 you're talking about, is there a player in this Celtic 11 that is fit to tie the laces of one of the 11 you've just gone through?
Well, that's a debate. That's more of a debate for the supporters and everybody else. As a player,
there is an issue of quality for whoever gets that job as well.
Well, yeah, I think good players is needed. You know, you need good players as well. You need good players that can handle playing in front of 60,000 fans every week. And you need good players that can handle when you go to Ibrox and it's a red hot atmosphere. And can be brave and control the ball and pass the ball. And you need experience. You need a bit of youth. You need guile. You need a good striker. Defenders, for me, defending, wins you games. But ultimately, and that gives the strikers an opportunity then to go and score goals and obviously win you games as well. But you don't get anywhere conceding two or three goals every weekend. You know, if you can't defend... If you can't defend set pieces, you're expecting your team to score 3-4 goals every week. That ain't going to happen. You've got to win ugly sometimes. You might get away with playing badly and then you might just nick the game 1-0 because your defence have been really strong. But as I said, you need that type of manager, probably as well that can control some egos, a strong-willed manager, somebody who's very confident in how he puts himself across. And somebody, of course, that can deal with pressure, because it's Celtic now. They have to respond. They have to respond. It's a massive season because, Rangers will go into next season having momentum and having a lot of confidence. And they will feel how easy, how simple it's been this season to win the league. Celtic have not put up a fight. It's 21 points with 7 games to go. Mm. You know, they have won the league before the split. So that's the type of manager that's needed. Now, you mentioned Roy Keane. Roy would be excellent. I think he'd be well respected amongst the players. He would have learnt a lot in terms of what he's achieved up to now.
Would you not be concerned that he hasn't managed a team for a decade?
No, not really, because I think, he's come from an assistant role. I wouldn't be concerned. And you know me, if I didn't think Roy wasn't the person that could galvanise the team and get them going and organise, then I would be the first one to say that. But I think Roy would be good. I also think somebody like Eddie Howe played brilliant football at Bournemouth, kept them in the Premier League, plays exciting football on the front foot, with Callum Wilson and Joshua King and these type of players. He had good defences as well at Bournemouth. So I think he would be good. I think he's got a lot of experience. I believe he's actively looking for a job. He's not in a job. Steve Clark, I think, again, would be probably my number one to go to if he was available. But obviously, he's in charge of the national team, Scotland. I think Steve Clark did a fantastic job at Kilmarnock. I think he's worked with the best in the past in terms of learning and picking up things from being an assistant. He's got Scotland in the Euros. We will see how Scotland do there. And he would be, for me, somebody that if I had the opportunity and I was picking a manager, I would probably opt for somebody like Steve Clark. But there's also Mark Hughes. Mark Hughes, Eddie, he brings in a staff with him. Eddie Nidzwicki, Mark Bowen. He had 3 ninth place finishes at Stoke in the Premier League, managed at Blackburn. He's also managed Wales, took Wales to a playoff. We got beat to Russia in the second leg of a playoff. He's been at Manchester, he's been at QPR. So, I think, Sparky, his attention to detail is... he doesn't leave a stone unturned in terms of his preparation, and his methods on the training ground. Whether or not he would be looked at. I don't know. But again, somebody I've worked with is Mark. And again, out of a job, and I think he'd be somebody that would, and I think a lot of people would take the Celtic job. I think it's a massive club. It's a global institution of a football club. And I believe it's a brilliant job.
By the sounds of what you're saying, John, you want experience. It sounds like you feel maybe it's a bit too soon for John Kennedy.
Well, I think I agreed with Jackie McNamara at the weekend on Sky, the live game Jackie was on. And I roomed with Jackie for 5 years while I was at Celtic. Great lad, managed himself, you know, managed Partick, Dundee United. He's an agent now. He's very wise, Jackie, very intelligent boy. Doesn't say a lot, quietly spoken. But when he speaks properly. And he's one of them that you listen to and you take things from what he says. And he spoke brilliantly on the weekend when he was live on air. They asked him about John Kennedy and he said, John, as no doubt you've seen off three Celtic managers at Celtic. I think it's Ronnie Dyler, Brendan Rodgers, Neil Lennon. He's been assistant to all three. And they tell me he's a great coach, John. Jackie said the same. You know, he's a fantastic coach. But he would like John Kennedy to maybe go and take a role somewhere away from Celtic and maybe prove himself a little bit as the number one, because being an assistant is totally different, you know, to being a manager, because your head's not on the chopping block as a coach. You don't have final say of the team. Nobody blames you as the number two. It's always the manager that gets the sack. And the manager, as I said, the manager is the one who takes all the flack. The assistant manager just can sit in the background and say, well, you know, we'll do whatever he's doing, continue to try and improve the players on the training ground. And that's where John's been. So to throw John in, John's a good lad. Again, I played with him before he got his horrific injury. I played with John. He's up and coming, great prospect. He's a Celtic boy as well. He come through the ranks. So for me, I agree with Jackie. And Jackie said he would like to see John just go and, you know, cut his teeth. There's not really a word that I like. But, you know, maybe go and take a manager job, because, you know, I think he would get one on the back of the people that he's worked with at Celtic and being a coach. A good football man, knows what he's talking about, speaks ever so well. And being around Brendan Rodgers, you know, for them 3 years, being around Neil Lennon, who's had a lot of games as a manager, he would get a job and hopefully he could do very well and then come back to Celtic. Maybe he feels if he goes away, he might not get another opportunity. Maybe that's why he's not deciding to do that. We don't know. He might do it at the end of the season. We don't know. But that's what Jackie said, and I tend to agree. Go and take a manager's job somewhere else as a number one.
Yeah.
Get the results, do well, and then the Celtic opportunity, you know, to manage them might come then. So that's what I'm talking about. They may well give the job to John Kennedy. I don't know what.
Yeah, rushes. The other thing, they can buy their time.
Not really, but they need to be proactive. They can't wait too long.
Mm.
You know, they can't wait too long. You know, because a manager needs to be put in place, because there's work to be done. You know, there's going to be a lot of a big turnaround at Celtic in the summer. There's a lot of players going to have to go back to their respective loan clubs. There'll be four or five players that maybe want to leave. You know, we've already lost Frimpong and Taylor's out injured. You know, Edouard will probably want to leave the centre forward. He wanted to leave a long time ago. Ayeti's not been good enough. Paid $5 million for him. Barkas has not been good enough, the Greek international goalkeeper. So we need a new goalkeeper. You know, we need more forwards. You know, we can't go into next season, get to July and it's pre-season and you haven't got a recognised striker, a proper striker that's going to go and get the goals to claw the title back next season, and you haven't got a number one goalkeeper. So there's so much to do.
Yeah, where do you start?
Where do you start, yeah?
just before we let you go, Arsenal have conceded against Olympiacos. It's Olympiacos 1, Arsenal 1. We've got the North London Derby live here on Off the Ball on Sunday. Arsenal against Spurs. Spurs are 1-0 up against Dinamo Zagreb. It feels like it's one step forward, two steps back at the moment for Arsenal. Every time you feel they're getting a bit of momentum, the mistake at the weekend from Xhaka, it's such a setback. Have you been impressed with Arteta? Do you feel there is enough progress this season?
Well, I think when he first came in, you know, hit the ground running, won the FA Cup, did very well, changed things around a little bit, improved the discipline of the team, got rid of Guendouzi because of his attitude, I believe. You know, sort of laid the law down in terms of what he wanted. Again, you know, he started with a four tonight with Bellerin, Gabriel, Luiz and Tini at left back. I actually did the game a couple of seasons ago when they lost to Olympiacos at Highbury, a really close game, and they went out. So I think they will get past this team. I think they'd want to a bit of revenge for how they went out a couple of years ago. I think they will get past Olympiacos when they go back to the Emirates next week. I don't think they're a particularly a good side, although they've equalised in Greece tonight, obviously. Arteta, I think he's going to get the run at it. I think they have got no intentions of doing anything with Arteta. I think he'll get time. I think he'll get funds. You know, and I think they'll go with him, and they'll give him that type of confidence. I think they believe in him, and as you said, I agree with you there. It is like, you know, they have a couple of great wins, and they go and beat a really good side, and then they might lose at Wolves or the way they went out with a whimper at Southampton this season in the FA Cup. You know, they went out and didn't perform, didn't turn up. Players looked a bit disinterested, but I think in Arteta, he's got some good players there. He's got some good young players, Alexa, Saka, Smith Rowe, Martinelli, Tini. You know, I can go on really with the young players. So he's got to build around them as well. You've seen in recent years, you know, Arsenal have let really good players go, letting their contracts run down, which ultimately, you know, it destroys the fans when you see one of your best players and through not getting him tied down and doing the right thing from a board level or from a manager's level costs you good players. You know, you like Van Persie went and one or two others. Aaron Ramsey was allowed to leave on a free, but maybe that was his own fault. But no, I think Arteta, I think he's got great potential. He's already shown what he can do. And I'm delighted they're sticking with him, because you look at Wenger, who's had a long time, and then you had Emery, I think, who only had 2 or 3 years, and they decided to change again. You can't keep chopping, changing managers. I know Chelsea do it regular, but I don't think that's the blueprint for Arsenal. So I think they'll stick with Arteta, and I think they'll back him. You know, I like Arsenal. You know, I was there for two seasons, and you know, I got a lot of time for the club. You know, great fans, biggest club in London for me. Might not be the richest club in London, but the biggest. So again, I'm glad they'll stick with Arteta. That's how I feel, and hopefully he brings a bit of success to the fans.
John, great stuff. Spurs have gone 2-0 up against Dinamo Zagreb. Harry Kane going into that derby in sensational form. 2 goals tonight to go with his brace. Yeah. The last day for Spurs. Well, we're going to have that live and off the ball from 4:30 on Sunday. John, great to talk to you as always. Mind yourself.
Okay, pleasure. All the best.
Olympiacos 1, Arsenal 1, and Spurs 2-0 up against Dinamo Zagreb. And just in case you're keeping an eye on the golf, Shane Lowry is flying at the Players' Championship. 5 under par through 11. He's just 2 shots off the lead. So we'll keep a close eye on that for the evening. We'll take a quick break, though, and then we're going to be talking to Vinny Perth.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Show Me the Science with Professor Luke O'Neill.
A Newstalk original podcast series focusing on different issues, from the serious to the silly. All explained through science. Catch up on the podcast series at newstalk.com or on the Newstalk app.
At Harvey Norman, we've got big deals on home appliances and technology. Save €1,200 on the Samsung 55-inch flagship QLED TV, now €1,499. Or get the Samsung 8kg washing machine, now €449, save €150. And at Harvey Norman, we're matching all competitors' prices, even their sale prices. So why shop anywhere else? Shop online at harveynorman.ie or safely in our spacious stores. Open until 6pm daily for home appliances and essential technology. Go!
Get ready for the Cheltenham Festival with the Boyle Sports app, with markets available on every festival race, plus free live streaming on all UK and Irish horse races. The Boyle Sports app has got you covered. Need to study up? Check out our Racing Post insights or watch our exclusive video previews with Cheltenham Gold Cup winning jockey Robbie Power. The Cheltenham Festival on the faster than ever Boyle Sports app. Boyle Sports. This is betting. Gamble responsibly. See gamblingcare.ie. 18 plus.
Looking to upgrade your van or pickup? The Ford Upgrade and Save promotion can help you do just that. Save up to €6,500 and future-proof your business. There's the eco-driven Ford Transit and Transit Custom, with mild hybrid and plug-in hybrid powertrains. And the 2020 International Pickup of the Year Ford Ranger. All tough, all reliable, all capable. All yours for less. Search Upgrade and Save or text Ford to 50015 and we'll arrange a call with your local Ford dealer. Texts cost a standard rate. Vehicles must be registered by March 31st. Terms and conditions apply. See Ford.ie for full details.
At Tesco, we've got value with Mother's Day in mind. Get brunch sorted with a Tesco Finest breakfast box for only €4. Don't forget the flowers with Tesco Finest Surprise or Sweetest Hydrangea set, only €25 each. And why not pop the bubbly with Tesco Finest Prosecco, only €10. Tesco, every little helps. Enjoy alcohol responsibly.
Introducing Go Loud Classical, the new home for your favorite composers. Music to raise you up. To inspire and to soothe. Go Loud Classical, the world's greatest music. Download the Go Loud app now for free. Go Loud, podcasts, radio, and music to your ears.
Sign up to Air today and get totally unlimited fiber broadband straight to the heart of your home with Ireland's number one broadband provider. And get Amazon Prime Video on us for a whole year. That's totally unlimited broadband for seamless streaming and downloading. Plus Amazon Prime Video on us for a year for just £29.99 a month for 12 months. For more, call 1-800-500-300 or visit air.ie. Air, let's make possible. Subject to availability, pricing refers to Air Gigabit Fibre 150 meg. For full terms and conditions, go to air.ie/gigabit fibre.
I'm Sonia Lennon. Every day, Dress for Success Dublin provides workshops, mentoring and presentation skills for women in need, supporting them to employment and economic independence, all for free. And that's why we need your support. Donate your commute. Contribute the cost of your journey to help others on theirs. Find out more now at dressforsuccessdublin.org.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Fake crowd noise? The Emirates never sounded so good. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Thursday's football show. Still Olympiacos 1, Arsenal 1, while Spurs 2-0 up against Dinamo Zagreb. There's around 12 minutes left in both those games. Earlier, Manchester United, a 1-0 draw with AC Milan. AC scoring in injury time for a drawn Rangers, drew 1-1 away at Slavia Prague. Now, Vinny Perth is on the line, just as Arsenal go in front. A cracking goal from the centre-back, Gabriel, has put Arsenal in front in that game at Olympiacos. Vinny's line has just dropped for the moment. So Arsenal, looks as though there ain't going to be any real issue. They had a corner kick over on the right-hand side. They took it short to Willian. Willian sent it in deep, and Gabriel came in with a powerful header. Sent it right back where it was coming from, to the back post, past the goalkeeper. And Arsenal, who had been looking comfortable for a good chunk of the game, conceded a sloppy equaliser, but have now got themselves back in front. So Arsenal in that one, leading by 2-1. I think Vinny Perth is with us. You there, Vinny?
Yeah, I'm loud and clear now. How are you doing?
I'm okay. some news this evening from an Irish point of view. Not good news. It never is good news, it seems, these days when we're talking about Ireland. Darren Randolph is out of the upcoming World Cup qualifier. So Stephen Kenny was doing, I think, a bit of a question and answer session with some supporters clubs tonight. And Dan McDonald's reporting that Kenny said, "We have some injury problems in goal at the moment. Darren won't be fit to be selected for the March window. I've been speaking to him over the last few days and West Ham have shut him down at the moment. He started the game really well, but the defenders had to take kickouts in the second half. Obviously, very unfortunate. Also, he said Queeveen Keller is injured at the moment as well. He has a slight abdominal tear, so we're just hoping he'll be okay. He's due back training at the weekend of next week. So probably just, what are we at that stage? 4 days before that first game against Serbia. This is pretty disastrous if Kelleher doesn't make it, because you're looking at the backups. Kieran Westwood is also injured at the moment. Mark Travers has made two appearances for Bournemouth so far this season and would probably be the most likely to start if Kelleher doesn't make it. And after that, you're probably down to Gavin Bazunu, who has been playing at Rochdale. But yeah, Stephen Kenny cannot catch a break when it comes to injuries at the moment, Vinny.
No, it's really bad news tonight. And obviously, I think there's a call for whether Queeveen is good enough to start for, and I think it would be brave, but also think I would do it. So if he's available, I think he'd play. It's a pity he's got the injury at the time, because he would have played a couple of games with Alisson struggling as well with his own personal issues earlier in the month. So the timing of it is awful. Travers did go on loan, I think it was to Swindon, and was playing, and then was recalled because of Bournemouth's injuries issues, but was recalled as cover, unfortunately. There's a goalkeeper there. Obviously, Gavin Bazunu looks like now he'd be leased in and then around the squad, but there's a guy in Lawler that's currently playing with Doncaster, and he's on loan with Oldham. And funny enough, I've watched him play two or three times in the last couple of weeks, and he's 26, a Dublin lad, went to Man City as a young lad. For me, he has to be in the squad at very least. And at 26, he's a right age for a goalkeeper. I think he's a really promising goalkeeper. Yes, he's playing at a low enough level, but he's playing regularly for Oldham and the mid-table league too. But he's been excellent, and he's someone that I know will be on the radar of the Irish setup. So I think he's someone that has a real chance of being involved if Kelleher doesn't make it. So, but it is ultimately, it looks like it's a bit of a blow in terms of, from a positional sense.
Yeah, and even then, Darren Randolph hadn't been playing for West Ham anyways, and Queeveen Kelleher has barely been playing. So, yeah, it's not an ideal situation. Is there any goalkeeper in the League of Ireland that could be in contention?
No, I don't think that will happen. You may have one or two that will train, but I just don't see that being the case. I think, as I said to you, I know they will have looked at Ian Lawler, for argument's sake, Gavin Bazunu. So you've got two or three already ahead of the curve and playing at a decent level in season as well. The League of Ireland goalkeepers are out of season, so it will most likely go that way, with Travers being, if the two number ones, for want of a better word, I think Travers, Lawler and Bazunu would be the makeup of Ireland's three goalkeepers.
Yeah. We saw what a disaster the first 3 months of this ended up being because of COVID issues, because of constant injuries. And there are bright spots. And you talk about those young goalkeepers coming through. There's so many young centre-backs and central midfielders coming through the system that eventually you feel there will be the basis of a strong squad there. But this is a Serbian side who are probably the great underachievers in Europe in recent seasons with what they've done at underage level. Again, Stephen Kenny is starting on the back foot here. It's very difficult to see them going to Serbia right now and getting a result.
Yeah, I think obviously the injury to the likes of Egan is a major blow. Duffy's form, etc. And then with your goalkeeper, so that's such a key position. Our centre forwards aren't even really playing, never mind scoring goals. So it doesn't look good at the moment. It looks like we're sort of 12 to 18 months away from a lot of players coming through. Like, people say Jason Malumbi has to play, but and that's where I suppose, and I understand it, but it, Irish eyes and normal fans is on the Premiership, but down below the league, by and large, Alan Brown starts ahead of Jason Malumbi. Sometimes they play together. Alan Brown does play in some different positions. Sometimes he play right full. But Jason is just finding his feet. The loan spell at Preston has gone quite well, but it's probably a little bit early for someone like him to go over to Serbia and boss the midfield for us. So we have got some things that have looked good. It looks like Coleman should come back. He's been in really good form. He's had a little bit of an injury over last week, but that's been massive. Matt Doherty's form has been much better recently. Enda Stevens has got over his couple of injuries. So, yeah, but it looks like, look, what this management team can't do is build a team for someone else to come in a couple of years' time and kick on. They have to get their own set of results. So, there's no doubt because of the first eight games, they will feel under a little bit of pressure to get some results. And
yeah,
it made it difficult for them.
Stephen Kenny names his squad this day next week, so we'll have plenty of reaction on next week's show to that. The reason we got you on, Vinny, actually, was to talk about coaching and coaching badges. We're very tight for time because of technical reasons, so I think what we might do is leave that chat for another night when we can have a proper deep dive into it, because this obviously came up during the week around Dundalk and Felipe Giovannioli and not having the pro license, and there not being a pro license course to go on anytime in the foreseeable future. You had a similar-ish situation at a time in Dundalk as well. So we did want to talk about how difficult it is to get on the pro license, how difficult it is to go through the system, and also then what happens on the pro license course. So we might do that over the next little while and maybe get the FAI involved as well. We are on the eve of the League of Ireland season, the President's Cup, Shamrock Rovers against Dundalk. Patrick Hooban's comments have been coming up quite a bit over the last few weeks. Listen, are you really champions of half a season? Can you call yourself champions? Stephen Bradley wasn't particularly impressed. You know, we're inside their heads. Was it foolish to have a little pop at Shamrock Rovers? Surely, if it was 2 points at the end of half a season, maybe you can say yes. But Dundalk found themselves so far behind. Surely they can't be questioning Shamrock Rovers' credentials.
Well, what I will say is, I think both are right. I mean, we'll only like. If Dundalk win on Friday, people will say Pat Hooban got in the head of Stephen Bradley. If Rovers win, people will say the opposite. So there's no right or wrong with it. I think what it has done is create a little bit of tension around the game, and it's great and it's good. To be honest with you, it's not sitting on the fence. I actually think technically both of them are right. The last year's season was 18 games with a 5.5 month break in the middle of it. So it wasn't that real. Rovers went to Dundalk and won 4-0 because they did the European game 2 or 3 days later and they played against some kids. But there's no doubt that the job Stephen Bradley has done has been phenomenal over the last couple of years to take that such a big club back to the top of the league. And they were the best side. And they probably would have won the league over 36 games, but it is.
They almost certainly would have won the league.
Yeah, well, I'm not doubting that in any way, shape or form. On and off the pitch, Shamrock Rovers deserve to be champions. Everything they do about them is what all the other clubs need to aspire to do, on and off the pitch. And so I think both of them, these comments are great. They're not, we had days of Pat Dolan and Roddy Collins. They're not quite that, yeah. But to be fair to Pat, he's not afraid to speak his mind. I think Chris Shields probably summed it up quite well, saying 36 games is a different animal, but to be fair, Rovers were the best team. I think that sums it up quite well, you know.
Looking ahead to the season, and we'll do more of this over the next week ahead of the start of the League of Ireland season, Rovers were very impressive at times last season, but they have lost Jack Byrne, they've lost Aaron McInniff, Graham Burke is still there, they brought in some real experience from Dundalk as well. Are they starting this season as strong favourites to go and do it in a 36-game season?
I think it's difficult to call. Rovers on paper, I would say, are favourites, absolutely. I think what swung it for me to make them favourites was the signing of Sean Gannon and Sean Hoare. The challenge is, and where you have to question where Rovers sit now, is the loss of Jack Byrne is huge. He's been the talisman of the league over the last two seasons. Of that, there's no doubt. But for me, ironically, the best player in the league was probably Aaron McAniff. I think his goals were huge for Rovers, his running power. Everything about what Aaron has done has been exceptional. Yes, Jack is the star, and rightly so. But Aaron, the two of them are big losses. Now, what Rovers have added is good, experienced players. They lost the cup final because ultimately I don't think the bench was good enough. Dundalk's was better. And he's learned from that, and they fixed it with some of their signings. So I think, yes, we don't know where Dundalk are. We don't know how good and how bad the players they've signed are. It looks like it was the right thing to do, because I don't think there was the real strength and depth in this country for Dundalk to go and sign Irish-based players. I think they had to take a risk. I still think they should have held on to Gannon and Horn. I think that's a mistake. Like, Dundalk have lost between the two of them and, say, even Gary Rogers. They've lost, like, 15, 16 league titles out of dressing room. So, but they've still got some real strong players there, and they have a right mentality about them. They just need to hit the ground running. The new signings have to go well for them. But, as I said, on paper, Rovers, clear favourites. But there is question marks on Rovers because of the loss of two massive players for them.
And what about the rest then? Do you see Bowes, Pats closing the gap at all?
I think I don't see Bowes closing the gap. I think they'd be happy to be in the, again, qualifying for Europe. Obviously, the staff there will want to kick on. But I think they've lost Twardock and the other... Danny Grant, sorry. And that's a massive blow for them. They haven't really replaced it, but they've brought in players who could replace it. So we'll find out. For me, Pat's signings have been excellent. I think Stephen has done a brilliant job in the off-season. The only question mark on Pat's is, I don't see real strength and depth there, but their 1-11 is very good. Coughlin, Billy King, really strong footballers. I think, thereabouts, the midfield, the Forrester, Benson, really, really good. They'll be really strong this year, and I think they've done well. And the other one, who looks like on paper they've signed really well, is Sligo. Some excellent signings, some sort of clever work by Liam Buckley. So I think they look like your top five on paper. And then, like anything in League of Ireland, it's no different every year. You'll always get someone who'll spring and surprise us, and you'll get someone who should do better that really struggled. So it's an interesting year ahead. I think what a way to start it this weekend with the two clubs who, I suppose, should be the top two fighting it out come the end of the season.
Vinny, great stuff. We'll come back and we'll do that coaching chat over the next couple of weeks. Thanks a lot for that.
Talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Fake crowd noise. The Emirates never sounded so good. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Shh. Listen. That's the sound of a quieter, cleaner future, led by Volkswagen, Ireland's best-selling car brand. Led by our all-electric, carbon-neutral ID3 and ID4 models, and our plug-in hybrid range. And led by all of you, joining us on our way to a zero-carbon future. Volkswagen.
Nobody likes arriving home to a chilly house. Make sure you're always cozy when you smarten up your home with Bord Gáis Energy. Get a free Hive Active heating control and a free Amazon Echo Dot, giving you better control of your heating. Plus, you'll get 25% off electricity and gas. Search Bord Gáis Energy Bundle. EAB €1,511, 12-month discount on standard unit rates with direct debit and paperless billing. 24-month contract with early exit fee €50. Unit rate standing charge apply. Prices valid today and may vary. See boardgoshenergy.ie for EAB and full T's and C's.
Why have thousands of Irish businesses already signed up for the Advantage card from OnPost Commerce? Well, it gives you a massive 34% off standard parcel labels and discounted stamps too, helping you cut your delivery costs. So make sure your business is taking full advantage of these fantastic savings. Get yours free today at your local post office or visit onpost.com/advantagecard. on Post Commerce for your world. Terms and conditions apply. Offer ends April 30th.
Leaving certificate and leaving certificate applied students due to take final examinations in 2021. You have the choice to sit the leaving certificate examinations or receive accredited grades from the State Examinations Commission or both. You must register on the candidate portal and indicate your choice for each subject, confirming your subject levels. The candidate portal is now open until Tuesday, 16th of March at 6 p.m. at gov.ie/leaving certificate.
At Centra, we have everything you need for Mother's Day with great offers. Like Centra Fresh Irish Round Roast, half price only $5.99 per kilo. Cadbury Milk Tray, 360 gram, only $6.35. And until Sunday, Graham Norton's Frizzante Rosé, now only €8. Centra, live every day. Enjoy alcohol sensibly.
If there's one thing all mums need this Mother's Day, it's something to look forward to. Why not give the gift of a voucher for one of Ireland's countless restaurant or accommodation options? There's so much to choose from yummy afternoon teas and glamorous dinners to a well-deserved night away. Treat your mum to a gift voucher this weekend so you can celebrate together when the time is right. Search online for the perfect Mother's Day accommodation or restaurant voucher today. Brought to you by Folcha Ireland.
I'm Sonia Lennon. Every day, Dress for Success Dublin provides workshops, mentoring and presentation skills for women in need, supporting them to employment and economic independence, all for free. And that's why we need your support. Donate your commute. Contribute the cost of your journey to help others on theirs. Find out more now at dressforsuccessdublin.org.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Only the cream of the crop pick up Champions League medals. Jonathan Greening's got one. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Arsenal have beaten Olympiacos 3-1 in the Europa League. Late goals from Gabriel and Mohamed Elneny after Martin Odegaard had scored in the first half. A brace for Harry Kane. Spurs beat Dinamo Zagreb 2-0 in the Europa League. Arsenal Spurs live on Sunday's Off the Ball. Earlier, Manchester United drew 1-1 with AC Milan. Rangers 1-1 draw at Slavia Prague. Shane Lowry still banging contention in the opening round of the Players' Championship. He is 4 under par through 12. 3 shots behind the leader Sergio Garcia. Congratulations to Justin Murphy, no relation, who identified Paula Radcliffe as the correct answer in our Aldi competition. Justin, you've won yourself a €300 voucher. If you missed out, we'll give you one last chance to win tomorrow night. OTBAM is live tomorrow from 7:30. Adrian and Owen will be back. There'll be a crappy quiz. They will have Alan Quinlan, Louise Galvin, Andy Mitten and lots more besides. And then tomorrow night we're back here on the radio from 7:00. Brian O'Driscoll and Friday Night Racing ahead of Cheltenham with trainer Paul Hennessy. That is us done for tonight. If you missed anything, John Hartson, Peter Crouch, John Giles, they're all up on the OTB Sports app. Subscribe to our podcast, the easiest way of getting them. We'll talk to you soon. Good luck.
Give him a ball and a yard of grass. He'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and a yard of spice. He'll give you a move with guilt like your eyes. Ra ta 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 ta.